everybody get around. As of 5 minutes ago, we're doing a lecture. Lecture is about impressioning. Impressioning is opening locks. Hey, Dana. Sit down and learn something. Impressioning is opening locks, but not so much with lockpicks as you're teaching next door, as you're learning next door. It's opening locks in a way that will end, in a way that you will end up with a working key. It takes some getting used to. First, an introduction. I'm Jos Weyers. I currently hold the impressioning world record. And, well, these things happen. I'm a member of Tool. I'm also a member of the open organization of Lockpickers, and I'm also a member of Hack42, which is a hackerspace in Arnhem. Hackaday, a couple of months ago, did a tour during Europe, and when they visited the hackerspace in Arnhem, they said it was the most awesome place in existence. And of course, I can only agree. If we're going to open a lock, first we have to know what a lock is and why we can pick it or opening or whatever. So we'll start off at 101 level. This is what we call a lock. As you can see, for most of you guys, this configuration will look upside down. That's because this is not taken in North America. This is called the Euro profile. That's the shape of the lock, and the keyway is directed that way. So in America, it's mostly upside down, but the basic way the lock works is exactly the same. So if we look at this lock, we see a round shape, and if that turns, we consider it open. That's it. Schematically, it looks like this. This is a huge round thingy, and we need it to turn. If we apply turning pressure on it, it doesn't. And if we take off the first layer, we see why it doesn't turn, because there's blue bits in the way. So if we try to turn this, with some luck, you can't, it can turn ever so slightly until this one is catched. That's it. And if we do push it down to the correct level, there you go, then it will turn and then we consider it open. I'm just explaining locks at the moment, and in a couple more slides we'll go further. So that was a one pin stack lock. That's quite easy. But normally there are more pin stack. In this case there are 5, and all these pins have to be on the correct level, and in order to open it. In real life we have a special tool for that, and that's called a key. So if you insert that key, the pins will align correctly on this level, and now it can turn. And even if it's off ever so slightly on one position, it won't turn. And this one is too low, that one's too high, so it won't turn. So how can we push all these pins at the correct level if you don't have a key? Well, in lockpicking, because the problem is, if you push this one down, it won't stick there. Well, actually it will, because in the real world, we use crap like this. This is supposed to be a straight edge, which it clearly isn't. These pins are supposed to be a true cylinder, which they clearly aren't. Well, these Korean pins, these are Korean pins and they really suck. But if you take a piece of metal and it has to be exactly the same size as another piece of metal, not gonna happen. You will have tolerances. Ever so slightly, maybe, if you machine it very good. But it will not be on the micron level exactly the same as the other part. So what enables you to do is if you start turning this lock, it's not six blue bits that are preventing it from turning. It's one blue bit preventing it from turning first, because it's more to the left, fatter, or the hole is drilled incorrectly or something like that. And as we looked at that one pin, if we push this one to the correct level, at this, so there's tension, and if you push it down, it'll turn ever so slightly. And with some luck, this one will stay on that ledge. So then we can move on to the other pin stack, and tick by tick, we can open that lock. So that looks a bit like this. So you put turning tension on it, go in with the feeler, that's just a spring pressure, just a spring, just a spring. That one doesn't want to go down, so we push it down until you hear or feel a click, and then that one stays. And then rinse and repeat 5 times until it's an open lock. Okay, so that's how a lock works, that is how picking works, and so we use tolerances within your lock to open that. Okay, different subjects. Impressioning. Impressioning. It's not new, this has been done for ages, especially by Secret Service guys, because it's a great way to get into a door. Because you leave hardly any marks, and once you're done with your attack, you have a key, which you can give to other operators. So you need the lock geek to get in, and then you can give it to the IT tech to get in, because they have to do evil stuff to the firewall, something like that. In a normal pen testing situation, or in a red team situation, or black badge situation, your team had to consist of a lock picker and a tech, because somebody had to do the tech inside and somebody had to open the door. Well, once you have done this attack in a successful manner, you end up with a key. And everybody can operate a key, so you do not need that lock tech in your further on attacks. So that's good. The question is, how long can I be in front of your server room or front door or any important door that you care about without being shot, detected, questioned, or dragged away? Is that 2 seconds? You're probably not that anal in your security that I'll be shot in 2 seconds, because that's going to be a problem. A minute? Can I be in front of your server room for a minute without getting arrested? 10 minutes? I think if I can be in front of your server room for 10 minutes without getting questioned, you have other problems. So there should be stuff about that. So if this chart is correct, then you should have a lock on your door that will, and suppose the break-even point is 5 minutes. So you need a lock on the door that the average attacker, that you keep away the average attacker for about 5 minutes. But what if the attack is 2 seconds? Because I'm pretty sure I will not be questioned within 2 seconds. Because I just walk up a door, oh fuck, wrong door, and gone. I will not be questioned within those 2 seconds. If I do those 2 seconds attacks twice a day for about a week, will that work? I think in most situations I will not be questioned, asked, shot, arrested, dragged off, whatever. Okay, let's play the situation. We start off with a lock. Same lock as before, but now you can see it's configured in the American way, so upside down for me. And I put in a blank key, an uncut key, as they hang at your key copying place. The key has to fit, though, so you need to have the correct blank for that lock. So it has to get in. Well, as we saw before, there are bits preventing it from turning. But now there's a chunk of metal in the way, so instead of the blue bits preventing it from turning, it's the red bits, right? Thank you, guys. So if we start to turn this lock ever so slightly, it will go a bit until the pins are preventing it from turning. So if I turn it to left or right, whatever, we'll see that this pin at the moment is binding. So it's stuck to the side. If we then wiggle that key up and down, then at this position, it will only be spring pressure pushing at my blank key, right? And of course, because there's metal in the way, I can turn the other way as well, which you can't do with lockpicking, because then all the pins will fall down. Now it doesn't, because they're held up by the key. So I turn left, up and down, and this, that was the pin that stuck to the side. So if I move my key up and down, that will push into your key. With quite some force, actually, if you turn hard enough. And with some luck, if I turn the other way, then it will push on another position as well. So if we do that, take the key out and examine it quite closely, you can see there and there, there's a slight mark on your key, a dent or a scratch or an indentation or whatever. If you look closely and on the proper lighting and maybe definitely some training and some magnification, you'll see that there's a mark there. What you do, well, and they look something about this. It takes some training and we'll try to visualize it with the microscope. Don't get your hopes up, because sometimes that doesn't work, but we'll try to. We'll have visuals. What we do, where these spots are, we take off a bit of material, just ever so slightly. If you know the brand and make of the lock, you can go online and figure out what that exact increment should be. If you don't know what the make and lock is, what the lock and what the brand and make of the lock is, just take small steps. That's basically what that's just ever slightly go down and down and down. This is not a working key, of course not. So we repeat that process. You go in, turn left. That's one binding, so that will place a mark there. If you go up and down, turn the other side. That one's binding. That will place a mark there. So we take it out, re-examine it, and we'll see marks in the valleys that we just created. And they'll look a bit like that. So you have a valley that we created, and there will be marks in those valleys, hopefully. So valleys with marks in them. What do? We take off material. Rinse and repeat. We keep on doing this. But if we turn to the left, that's the first stage, we'll see that that one is already at the correct level. So that red piece of metal, well, schematically, so this red piece is not preventing the lock from turning anymore. So for 20%, this lock is open, basically. So if we turn to that side, or if you turn to the other side, this one will probably still be marking, but that one isn't. So with some luck, another one will mark. So now we see that there's a marking there, and there's a marking there, and we keep on repeating this, and there will be marked at several places, and in the end, you end up with a working key. That's the original that I didn't see at the moment, of course. This was done during a competition. And this one looks a bit weird, because it's all round and stuff, but if you look at the important parts, that's the same, because the point in the middle of the valley, that's the one where your pins will interact with. So at that point, it needs to be the correct level. Okay, make sense? And if you're any good, you win prizes. And now we're gonna demo. See how that goes. Screenish, yes. We'll do this later. That's okay. Okay. I'll start off with a blank key, which is the surface looks a bit like this. So it's a bit of a lunar landscape. Well, a normal blank is thicker. There's more metal to your key than there should be. So what I do, I cut it down to the first level that is actual exists within this for this particular lot. I do this in competitions, and within competitions, we know beforehand what the make and model is of your lot. That's about ish. See it? I haven't touched the lock yet, right? So if you look now, I come up with this. So it's way smoother. And if there's a mark on this smooth surface, I will see it. At the lunar surface we had before, if there's a mark extra, that's going to be hard. Was that already there? If it's not. Okay, now first, put it in the lock. Tension on one side, wiggle it, other side, wiggle it. Now, that's the whole attack. I'll do it a bit more to get better marks so we can see it on the video. But normally that should not be the case. And I'm off. I'm no longer at the door. I move on to my van, whatever, take off sides. Yep, they're quite clear. Okay, let's see if we can get... You see that? That. Hold on a second. There. Try to get it in focus-ish. Come on. Oh, you see there's something, right? Okay. I have another one at position number... Where is it? Magnify. One. One and three. So at position one, take off some material. Same for number three. Rinse and repeat. Position three has something. And again, number one. If you don't see anything, turn it a bit into the light. So, am I focusing correctly? It's there. It's that mark. See that? It's in the that one. Okay? So take material off there. If you're not sure about a mark, rinse and repeat this step, but you can't unfile. And if you file too far, well, let's start over again, that's the only possibility. That's number three again. Yep. Number four. If you apply too much pressure, or a lot of pressure, then the marks will be perfect-ish, but there's of course a chance that your key might break. And when in training, you will have some breakage, I guarantee it. And with some training, your times will improve. Mind you, a normal competition, first rounds take an hour, and normally about half of the field opens. Last championship in Germany, only one person opened during that whole hour. So sometimes, well, you can't always be lucky. So keep on going back and forth to your luck. I'm not quite sure. I just filed, so I can't. So that's. I'll try to. I see only one mark on number five. That one. Sorry? Yeah, not always. So what I normally do, I look at it with my bare eyes, and I have magnification on hand. So. During competition, you see people with magnification helmet and lights and whatever. Whatever floats your boat. yeah. I normally use a small jeweler's vise, just a cheapo that you get on the at the craft store. So with the humilescent light and the magnification thing. I use a Grobet number four, but that we'll get into that later. But it needs to be quite a fine file. But not too fine, because then your surface will be too smooth, and if you put a light on it, it'll blind you and you can't see anything anymore. Let's see how that goes. Ta-ta! Yes. The last time I turned it, it does turn, but it didn't turn very smooth. Well, it does now-ish. What happens is that I'm a bit off, and if I force it to turn, the pins are forced into your key. So basically, it's the same technique as happened. You see, at this point, you see a whole chunk there. You see a whole chunk of metal is missing because that pin was forced into it. So that's the same that happens if I twist this, but all the other pins were on the correct level. There's only one pin left, so that's all that force is going in there. So now I have a working key, which I can, of course, give to the other operators who go in and do their dirty deeds at the site we're trying to investigate. So we have a key. Okay, if you wanted to have more information about... Yes, please. Sorry, can't.
If you were to use a much softer coating...
Yes, I understand. I understand. The gentleman suggests that you use a softer material as a key, basically, or use some softer material that you apply to the key. Some people have been experimenting with lead inserts in your key. It's messy, but it does work. What you can also do is get softer keys. So these are stock keys. Those are normally made from brass or something like that. You can get get aluminum keys, which is a bit softer. You can get steel keys, which is way harder. Well, the fun part about steel is it's way harder. So the chances of your key breaking off are slimmed down considerably. But because the keys are that hard, they won't mark. And if you use a softer material key, it'll mark like a mother, and it will break as well. So you need to have your optimum, and after extensive research, we came up with the stock stuff that's basically in the middle. So it's soft enough to actually give an impression, and it's hard enough for not to break. But you can fiddle about with different stuff and get inserts that are lead or whatever. Some people apply dye or Tipex or whatever. I don't like to apply dyes on there because it gets your lock messy. And after two or three turns, you go like, was this mark there or did I just make that? Or it kind of confuses the situation. But some people tend to like it. I'm just not one of those people. This is the book on impressioning. It's written by Oliver Dietrichsen, who is a German safecracker, basically. And he basically went into hiding for about a couple of months, and he wrote this book. This one is the German one, but there is an English translation. And it has all sorts of very nice pictures in it. And some of these, so you can actually see what's going on. You see the technique also works on dimple keys, because it's basically pins poking into your key. That's what normal pins are. And a dimple lock works that as well. Also with on the side. It's just more work, but once you get the hang of it, these are easy. Really easy. And it's fun. And it also has even pictures of the Kriminaltechnisches Spooflabor, which is basically CSI in Germany. So when you see very up close pictures of what is actually going on. Most people, when they start impressioning, they get the book, they get a beginner set, you can buy them here, get a proper file and start working. The hardest part in impressioning that most people find is interpreting the marks. Because filing, you can learn. Just file consistently and evenly and that'll work. Get your spacings right. So that's neat work, that'll work. But the only problem is, interpreting your marks and applying enough pressure. Enough being not too much as well. So to find that optimum, that's the problem. So what do you need for this opening technique? Well, you saw me using quite a lot of stuff. First, you need a measuring device if you're in training, because if you know your brand like I said before, you can go online and or get your technical sheet and figure out what how much material actually to take away. I have a little caliper for that. You can get the slide version as well. And what I did, I put markings on it for that particular brand, so I don't even have to read it. I just have to align my little pointy thingy to the correct line. So that's to get you in training, that to train your muscle memory how hard to push on your file. Files, we need files. We bought a shitload of files and tried everything. And the common opinion, what most people tend to like, is a Swiss cut number 4. And if we have to name a brand, that's probably going to be a Grobet. That's not a cheap file. Those cost money, but they're very good. And if you treat your files well, that's probably going to be the last file you're going to use, because they'll last ages. And so that's basically what we use. You need a contraption to hold your key, to hold your lock. So basically a vise. I use Monfrotto super clamps. They are from the basically movie and photo stuff. They're used to hang lighting fixtures at whatever. They're light and they look cool. And of course, if I travel with this through TSA, I'm gonna get a problem. And well, they weigh a lot. Also, you need a shitload of keys, because you will break keys when you start training. Because initially you go like, I don't see marks, let's apply more pressure, because if you apply more pressure, you get better marks. If you apply too much pressure, it'll break. You will break. Absolutely. You will break your keys. Which is not a problem, it's just a way of practicing. If you are practicing, if you never did a 100 meter with hurdles, if you start off with hurdles, you'll kick some hurdles. That's not a problem. That's part of the training. So to get that aim right, you will break a lot. And of course, you need keys that fit to your lock. A good way to get locks is hello eBay. And a better way is basically to befriend your local locksmith, because he'll sell you the locks and the keys. But you don't want to pay the premium price that they normally charge for a cut key, because that is going to be an expensive hobby. And it doesn't have to be. You need some magnification. I use this when in the field. It's basically a mag light with an add-on. There's a light through it. And this used to be used by geologists to look at stones, so to look very closely up or close. And somebody basically cut an extra slit out of it and start selling it as an impressioning device. And it works. It's just an add-on on a tiny mag light. So that works. I, at home and within competition, I use this, because then you can see the whole key. There's also custom-made fancy stuff like this. Neat idea. This is stupidly over-engineered and it basically doesn't work. But the idea is good. There's a bay here that you slip your key in. You can turn that. There's 4 buttons at the back, so you have white light, yellow light, UV light, whatever, and you can alternate it. And there's a magnification glass on the top. So if you're in the field, nobody sees you looking, because you're not creating a field of light. So it's only you with your tiny mini television to look at your lock. Neat idea, but badly operated. So build stuff like that. Also, you need a grip, because the force we apply to your key, well, you need big hands if you would do that with your bare hands, especially if you're in training, that's going to hurt. So to do it consistently, you need a grip. There are grips on the market, especially for this. This is a custom, this is an impressioning handle that's sold that way. If you want to go low budget, get a vice grip. That'll work. The only problem with vice grips that I find is if you're turning, you want to turn in the same line as your key. And if your vice grip does that, that's a weird way of turning. So you basically want to be in the same line as your key. And so this will work, definitely. You can build your own or whatever. I had some custom grips made. This is just a aluminum bar with a slit in it and two screws tapered in it. And and by now I work with these custom cut grips. They're made by Jort Knaap, which is a locksmith from the Netherlands, and he has a very good machine shop, and he does sell them. But, well, yeah, stuff like that. It's how custom, how well, it depends how much money you want to spend. For one very cheap, low-budget tool, which is very useful, is this. This is the core, the cylinder of the lock I wanted to open. So I get the same brand, same make, and I very crudely, with a big file, I file down until I see these round shapes. What that enables me to do, if I put a key in, if I'm halfway, so I'll take this sort of thing, put your key in. If you look, I don't have a picture of that. If you look from that way, you'll see the, can we see that? You see the round spaces where the pins are supposed to be. And if you put your key in, then all the marks that make sense, because they are made by the pins, they should be visible in the middle of that round space. So if you're looking for marks and there's crap all over the place, you go, that looks like a mark. But it can't be a mark because it's in the wrong space. So it must be something else. So this is very helpful while training to figure out, to ease away the panic, basically. So that works. And, sorry? Yeah, so you don't file off, so you know it's supposed to be there, so you go there, yeah. Another tool I use, which is also made by Jos Weyers, the same locksmith that I talked about, is the KGS tool. What it does, this is, again, the same cylinder, because all the games are done on the same brand of cylinder, so we know the spaces and stuff like that. And he took all the pins out and put nasty drill bits instead of those pins. And then he did some other stuff that you can actually turn it. If you turn it, this is your blank key, as it comes out of the box with the lunar surface. And once you turn it, these drill bits, they just hack into your key. So you know exactly where the pins would have been. And as I said, a blank that comes from the package, the first cut would be a zero cut, which never happens in real life. So you start off by everything cutting it to the first possible cut. And I know where to cut, so I take off enough material to get to the first possible depth on these positions. Sorry? Yes, that's a lot of competition. As long as it's within your own time. So you start off with a key that you have nothing done to. You're allowed to put it in your hand grip. That's it. And then the time starts, and if you want to start carving or putting help lines or way lines or whatever you want to do, that's all allowed. So yeah, that works. And if you want to be mobile, you can have a tiny, tiny little microscope on you with lighting and a tiny file, and that's it. That's all, basically that's all you need. A grip, a couple of blanks, a file, and some magnification aids. So that's it. Basically that's it. Any more questions? Sorry, I can't. I want to do this. That's probably my the master. I'll probably jump the fence. Way easier. Any more questions? Okay, I guess that's a wrap then. Thank you very much.